thanks very much for joining us today, for those in person and on the webinar, for the Aitken Partners Business Law Breakfast. Today's topic is future-proofing SMEs and an outlook on restructuring and insolvency for the financial year 2025. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Alex Nicol. I'm the managing principal here at Aitken and practicing restructuring and insolvency law. Today we'll be discussing the challenges, I suppose, that SME businesses are facing given the well-publicised financial headwinds that are at play at the moment, and the critical role that professional advisors across the board can play in guiding their clients over the next 12 months and beyond. We'll discuss a little bit about the current economic climate and what our panellists are seeing at the moment, and the challenges and opportunities that businesses face over the upcoming financial year. We do have three great panellists for today for an open discussion about these topics. On the topic of questions, please feel free to jump in throughout the session. Online, please type your questions into the Q&A function and we'll endeavour to get to those throughout the presentation. Otherwise, there'll also be an opportunity at the conclusion to ask myself and the panellists some questions. So it's now my pleasure to introduce our panellists. Erin, in the middle, is a senior associate at Aitken Partners in commercial litigation. She's got a broad range of commercial disputes under her belt, which includes many disputes that arise in the context of times when money is tight. That obviously includes contractual disputes, shareholder and director disputes, the recovery of both personal and company debts, and restructuring and insolvency. She also has experience on the commercial side of things in drafting the agreements, which becomes increasingly important in tough times, and also gives her a unique perspective when resolving disputes that arise from those contracts. Michael Bellingle, on the left, is a partner at Syracuse Accountants, specialising in business advisory and taxation for SMEs. He provides strategic guidance to those businesses throughout the whole life cycle, including in times of financial distress, focusing on financial and tax management and structuring of businesses to ensure optimal performance. Shane Kremen, on the right, is a partner at Rogers Reedy and is an expert in corporate insolvency and restructuring. With extensive experience across both formal appointments, restructuring and informal turnarounds, he's uniquely placed to guide businesses through financial crises and give us a great perspective today. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to our panellists. So firstly, I'd like just to, I suppose, reflect on the current position and like to ask each of you your views about where we are at the moment. And Mick, I suppose, to start with in particular, are you seeing businesses at the moment still wanting to grow or acquire other businesses through this climate? And if so, do you have any key pieces of advice for that approach?
Thanks, Alex. Yes, I am. Businesses are still feeling fairly acquisitive. They're apprehensive, but they're acquisitive. I'm seeing probably the biggest hurdle at the moment being funding requirements. So businesses are very cautious to acquire and grow, I guess, in a sense. But the funding hurdles are usually becoming a bit more onerous, and they're also taking a lot longer. So I'm seeing finance, you know, taking some months now where they never took nearly as long. I'm finding that to be quite a hurdle. I talk, most of my conversations will probably be around more savvy businesses, I will say. They've got the falling revenues, but they're just spending a lot of time trying to manage that gross profit margin, just trying to manage keeping their costs low whilst to track down with revenue, because I'm seeing a lot of lower revenues coming through. So the more savvy businesses are sort of keeping on top of that and being able to manage their margins pretty well that I'm seeing in my client base.
And Erin, I suppose, given what we're observing about the conditions at the moment, what do you see as the main warning signs that a business should be aware of through these difficult times?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of businesses now having financial distress, and a lot of that we're seeing flowing through into a lot more liquidations of businesses and a lot more creditors wanting to wind them up. So we might have had a time where creditors were a bit more lenient, particularly during COVID, but we're seeing that leniency is well and truly drying up, and they're willing to litigate and wind up the businesses when they get really frustrated. There's a lot of different indicators for different businesses about when they might be in financial distress. Sometimes it depends on the industry itself and the business, but there are some commonalities, and particularly ones like when they're having issues getting their debts paid themselves, when they're finding that they're having to renegotiate those trading terms. And one which I think lots of people miss or forget is that they're taking on a lot of risky business as well. So when business is going well, they have really good clients, they're picking up really good jobs, and then when that starts to drop off, what we're finding is they're taking on a lot of those riskier jobs in the hopes that that will get them a big paycheck at the end of the day.
Interesting, thanks Erin. And Shane, obviously by the time companies come and see you, they are facing difficulty, and so you're, I suppose, seeing that at the moment. What are you seeing as the key drivers for that? What are the motivators for companies coming to see you at the moment?
Yeah, we try and do a big push of companies coming into us proactively before they really are seeing the financial distress, but just the nature of the game is they put their hand up when it is usually a lot of doors are closed and they have got a lot of pressure from creditors. Cash flow is still one of the major crunches that companies are facing. It's always been there, but now more than ever in this economic climate. I mean, coming out of, as Erin mentioned, COVID era where there's a lot of support, companies couldn't enforce a debt. They couldn't pursue debts in the courts, wind each other up to get the cash in. Now, you know, it's that brutal. You know, they want their money. Companies are screaming for their money because they need to fix their cash flow issues. So it's back on, that's for sure. You might see statistics out there in the press, but the insolvencies are up about 50% on pre-COVID levels that we're seeing. And a lot of those are construction and hospitality, two of the biggest sort of sectors affected through COVID and the current economic environment, with labour costs, prices quite high. And also the ATO, as Erin mentioned, they're going very hard, looking at all their enforcement options and using those tools that they have available, DPN, stat demands, wind-ups. It's a big driver of the work that we're seeing coming in the door at the moment. I suppose to touch on the banks as well, I mean, they're still quite PR sensitive. They won't appoint unless they absolutely have to, but they won't necessarily refinance the customer if they've got their LVRs out of whack or they're breaching covenants. They'll say, no, go seek some other options. But those second, third tier financiers don't have an issue appointing mortgagee in possession receiverships as well. So we're seeing a lot of those pressures from their secured lenders as well.
So there is a bit of a flow down effect.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And so Shane's mentioned cash flow as a critical factor, which it always is, but becomes even more important. Mick, can you give us some insight onto some financial indicators that SMEs can keep a close eye on to make sure that they can proactively address these issues?
Yeah, certainly can. What I'm seeing a lot more of with the financiers is a request for forecasts, cash flow forecasts. Tell me what your next 12 months looks like. So I'm doing a lot more work around that. More recently, a bank asked me for a two-year forecast. So I had to go even further. I haven't done one of those before, or needed to, I should say. But it shows their level of wanting to really get a lot of certainty around what's happening, which means we've got to do a lot more work. Look, I do a lot of three-way forecasts, the banks require it. So a three-way forecast is a forecast balance sheet, profit, loss, and cash flow that all talk to each other. So you can build in the variables of GST, I'm collecting my debtors in 20 days, 50 days, and you put all these variables in and build a quite powerful model. And I must say, our practice is doing a lot more of that, and it's a lot more bank-driven than the board wanting it. One of the other major things we look at is your trade debtors listing. What are your debtor days? Who are your troublesome clients? Should they be on stop work or not? Which is always a fun conversation I have with my partners. Should they be on stop work? But I want to help them through it, but I want to be on stop work. And it's sort of a bit of a hard one to go, no, we're definitely not doing work on them anymore. But it's certainly something we have our conversations with our clients about. And I guess, as I said before, maintain that gross profit margin. You know, what can we do? You talk to clients, as you know, the professionals in the room will know, they're really ambitious, they're really positive, they're always very thinking their business is going well, I'm going to win that thing, I'm going to do this work. But they're always thinking above the line, and they're going, yeah, I can build it for 50 and I'll sell it for 100. But they've got all these overheads, insurance, the payroll, everything else they're not thinking about. They're just, you know, there is buying a job. Shane mentioned it earlier, just getting something just to get the turnover going. We are seeing a bit of that and having conversations around, are we pricing this right?
Aaron, from the side of a commercial disputes lawyer, what do you think a business can do to avoid these legal issues that often end up in litigation when they're facing these times of financial distress?
I think there's a lot internally that the business can do as a first step. Often, you know, the issue with cash flow that we've touched on is that some of those internal procedures that you have to recover your own debts, they've got relaxed over the years, or they're no longer front of mind. So really making sure that you're up to date with your internal procedures. And there's also, you know, a really simple step of when you are potentially on the brink of litigation, there's actually a lot that can be done just by keeping that line of communication open. A lot of the times we see litigation has started because one side feels really frustrated that there's been all of a sudden this lack of engagement and lack of update. And so keeping that line of communication open, even if that's without prejudice, so that you're making sure that whatever you do say doesn't come back and hurt you later on if a legal proceeding does end up on foot. And then there's a lot that you can do externally as well. And I think the most effective ones are getting advice early on. Often, you know, you leave it until the last minute, and that really limits in terms of what lawyers and insolvency practitioners can do. If you get advice really early, there's often a lot more that we can work with. And, you know, I think engage early, get that advice. There's often some simple strategies that they can bring in, which have a really great impact on the cash flow particularly.
Thanks. And I think each of us have touched on the ATO as one of the key drivers for this. And this is a question for any and all of you. Any insight into what the ATO approach is presently? And looking into the crystal ball, is that likely to change over the next 12 months?
I certainly see what they're doing once the enforcement avenues have been enacted, arising from the issue of the stat demand and the wind-up. And on the voluntary side, so things like voluntary administrations or informal workouts, it's once the director receives a director penalty notice where they're personally liable for GST, PAYG, superannuation debts, they're using those tools as well, being much more aggressive. I don't know what you're seeing on the front line, Mick, but...
Look, a lot more aggressive. They're chasing the debts. I think it's been publicised that small business taxes owing is something like $34 billion. It's a lot of money. You had including bigger companies.
SMEs, the current collectible tax arrears are at $34 billion. The total tax collectible arrears are at $53 billion. It's the highest it's ever been, coming out of post-COVID, where they were going that gentle approach. The government need the money and they're screaming for it, and ATO are acting accordingly.
So our office is getting many, many calls, lots of letters for our clients chasing debt. It's become very aggressive. Our ability to get payment arrangements has become harder. They're asking for more things, not tolerating, I guess, longer payment arrangements now. You could often get 2-3 years with good behaviour, maybe more. We're struggling for that right now. It's just becoming a lot harder. And I guess to a degree with those sort of numbers, I was talking to another professional and they were saying, yeah, we're helping clients collect debt as well, but they've got all these unlodged documents that they're actually not lodging, so the number could be far higher. Because if you don't lodge it, the debt doesn't hit the accounts and no one knows how much it is. So their answer of putting their head in the sand is, well, I just won't lodge the BASs. I don't want to know. So it's kind of scary to think what it actually could be.
And we also know what that means for a personal liability perspective too.
Mm.
Yeah.
Shoot themselves in the foot if they do take that approach.
We're seeing statistics on the DPNs particularly increase substantially. So if we look at during COVID, it dipped to about 3,000 per annum. Then it increased to almost 17,500 the following year. And then for the first half of last financial year, we're already at about 14,000. So there's a lot more director penalty notices being issued. And I think part of that is that the ATO have really streamlined that process. So they're no longer manually reviewing all of the DPNs. They're actually just automating them and sending them out. And we're also finding that people don't know what to do with them. So often they get it, they put it in their drawer, and then come to us months or years down the track and it's too late, unfortunately. So I think a lot more people are getting them. A lot more people don't know what to do with them. And we're also finding in enforceability in the courts as well. We had one the other month where the Deputy Commissioner of Taxation issued proceedings for a DPN and debt that was almost 11 years old. So they are still getting around to the enforcement action. The DPNs are quicker, the litigation takes its time, but they're still well and truly doing it.
Big interest bill on top of that.
Yeah.
So just to clarify, with the lodgement, as Michael Ono tells his clients, lodge, because then if you've lodged and reported, it avoids that personal liability if you're advising your clients or your directors. Mm-hmm. Don't put their head in the sand, because the debt just becomes yours.
So I'm hearing a bit of DPNs being issued to directors of companies that have been put away 10 years ago.
Yeah, we certainly see that. Mm-hmm. I had one recently where DPNs are issued for a company that's well and truly been in liquidation for 4 or 5 years. And the fact that they haven't lodged means that they've got locked down DPNs and they are still personally liable for that debt. You obviously can't cure it given the company's already in liquidation.
Okay.
And Mick, you mentioned that you're having to do more to persuade the ATO to even consider a payment arrangement. In my recent experience, they're certainly saying, well, we might consider it. You've got to pay a significant amount up front.
Yep.
They're looking for security over family homes and the like. And so they're saying, we might allow you to have some more time, but you're going to have to really show that you have the ability to pay the debt relatively promptly.
Yeah, it was always a good plan, and has been forever, to pay a lump sum up front and then drip feed thereafter. It always sweetened the deal, but those numbers are getting bigger. Or the percentage of debt is getting bigger. But even being able to show that you're drip feeding money and at least periodically, so if you can't afford it, can't afford the 2,000, just pay the 500 a week and just have that drip feed in. Just be better than the next guy. Be better than the guy not paying anything and not lodging. And not communicating. They're going to get a lot more of the attention, at least look partially proactive. Yeah.
And so, Mick, can you talk a little bit about your role and that of other financial advisors in working with your clients through times like this and what you can do to assist to protect or prevent against these issues arising?
Yeah, look, probably works actually very well off the last question, because it is about working with them, being honest with ourselves and being realistic with ourselves that we understand the numbers, we understand our exposure. We're working with a realistic forecast to understand where we're going with things and lodging. So it's a lot more client interaction, speaking with them, analysing where they really are, and working with their creditors to understand how much is owed, and I guess drip feeding them also, communicating with them, making sure they get paid, just to keep things moving.
Thank you. Shane, for those in the room who aren't aware, that the small business restructuring process has been around for a few years now, which was designed to, I suppose, simplify some of the insolvency processes for particular businesses, but the initial take-up was pretty poor with that process. What are you seeing more recently with the SBR process, and how do you see this process benefiting small businesses?
We love it. We really believe in it. We're one of the early adopters of the process, and I suppose initially it's new legislation. No one really understands what it means. How can it be used? Is it going to work? The creditor's going to support it? We saw some opportunities on it, especially coming out of COVID. A lot of companies have genuinely had a rough try, but have an underlying viable business there, but usually with a lot of tax debt, and it works. It's more suited to where it's a large ATO tax debt, not too many other creditors, because you need their approval for the deal. They tend to get a bit nervous, but not to say it can't be done, and we have done it. But we went out and really hit it hard in an educational piece to accountants, lawyers, the key advisors to clients about what it is, how it can be used. We've done just under 100 of them, had a very, very good success rate. And going back to the ATO, yes, they are going hard in collection, but they are supporting these. What it is almost a mini deed of company arrangement VA type deal to businesses that meet the criteria. So the debts have to be under $1 million. Entitlements have to be paid. So super zone has got to be fixed up first. And we do a comparison. Here's what creditors would get in a liquidation scenario if this was shut down or sold. And here's the offer. Here's what the directors are going to commit to paying you over. It can be done over a period of time in installments or in a lump sum up front. Where we've restructured over $30 million in debt so far, and an average return of about 21 cents in the dollar. So we've done returns from 10 cents up to around 40 cents is probably the highest, because they had some properties and you know, the liquidation scenario is quite high in that one. But the ATO, we have a dialogue first. We talk about the proposal, any requirements they want, go back and fine-tune the proposal and then set it in stone. And as I said, we've out of the almost 100 we've done, we've only had one that wasn't successful, and there were some pretty specialised circumstances where the directors weren't going to sell property or pay their loans, and fair enough, the ATO didn't like it. So it didn't get up. But yeah, that's right. I think they had about 3 properties and they weren't willing to sell any to pay their tax. So again, we're seeing lots of success, and I know Michael and the Aikens team here are big supporters of it as well, because the client stays viable, becomes viable again, cleans the balance sheet up, the employees stay employed, and it just avoids that worst case scenario of liquidation that we see.
And one of the requirements is that your lodgements have to be up to date as well, which just reflects that ATO approach of encouraging people to actually lodge, which then means that they're more likely to support these types of things, which is what Shane's just reflected on. So Shane, can I ask you to, I suppose, expand a little bit on what the other options are to companies that face this financial distress and what they can do, either talking to their advisors or to someone like yourself?
Yeah, as we've all touched on earlier, the earlier the better. I mean, there's more doors open if a client comes to us with their situation, there's more levers you can pull and options available. The longer you leave it, there's enforcement already taking place, or the cash flow's dried up, it really limits some of the formal options that are available. But you've got the usual, been around for a long time now, the voluntary administration period, which enables you to restructure debt, propose a deed of company arrangement where you're putting a proposal to your creditors of cents and a dollar, as opposed to creditors voting to wind up the company at the second meeting. So that can really be very broad what you can do within a deed of company arrangement. You can restructure debt, you can downsize, you can offload some debt-laden assets as well. And again, with the view of keeping the company viable going forward and coming out the other end with the workforce retained, usually. Creditors accept, okay, they need to take a haircut, otherwise it wouldn't be in this position, but it comes out the other side, they continue, those that want to support it, continue to supply and deal with the company, continue to trade. And that can be, we've done listed entities through to SMEs and mum and dad companies as well, that remains a sound option for if they're proactive. The other methods are the usual creditors voluntary winding up, where if there's not, the business isn't viable, there's no restructure there that's viable, it's a straight liquidation appointment where we close the doors, it caps the liability so they can't continue to trade and incurring debt that might become the director's personal liability. If the employees are eligible for the government FEG scheme for their entitlements on the liquidation, so there's some other benefits of doing a straight wind up too in certain circumstances, but where we can, we try and avoid that. We like saving businesses and companies and keeping everybody employed. So that's what we aim to do.
Thanks, Shane. And Aaron, when a business is facing this, I suppose, cash flow pinch that we've spoken about across a few issues today, do you think they should be more or less willing to pursue litigation to recover money? And are there other options around that to, I suppose, mitigate that cost to businesses when they are struggling for cash?
Yeah, I think a lot of businesses immediately think, well, I'm tied on cash, so the last thing I want to do is engage a lawyer or somebody else to actually pursue it in the courts. And I think what people forget is that often you can spend a little bit of money but gain a lot in return. So when looking at a business that's tight on cash and there's potential litigations around, what we would look at is what's kind of the low-hanging fruit in the courts? So is there something which we can do which might not be the biggest claim that they have, but it's big enough and it's probably got the least amount of risk, where we can pursue that quickly, cost-effectively, get some more money in the door, and then we can assess, well, what do we do with that money? Is that best for the business to use to trade, or do we put that back in and then pursue some of these more lengthier legal proceedings? So often that comes in the form of where the debt recovery procedure for the business has kind of dropped away. They've, you know, loosened all of those great processes that they had. And so you might send out 10 letters of demand. If you get payment on 3 to 5, that's fantastic. You've immediately covered the legals that you spent, but then you also, depending on the size of the debt, you've got enough to fund those other 5 if you want to, issue legal proceedings, or is there another litigation which has a higher quantum, which is worth putting that money into? And the other thing I think as well, which is really important, is to consider how you fund those legal proceedings. I think there's now a lot of flexible arrangements out there, and litigation funders as well.
Yeah, and just to pick up on that, I mean, the litigation funding market in Australia is certainly developing, and it's often been used, and you hear about it in the context of class actions and perhaps insolvency a little bit, but certainly they're strongly pushing businesses who want to take the cost of litigation off their balance sheet. But there are certainly arrangements where they can come in, fund the litigation. They certainly get a return on the potential upside if you are successful in litigation. But it means that ongoing monthly cost of paying the lawyers to run the claim is taken off, and so it de-risks it a little bit for the business. So there are options out there across a whole range of litigation funders. Shane, I mean, you touched on this a little bit a moment ago. Most people are aware of that liquidation scenario, so the worst case, where assets are sold off, companies close down. Can you give us just some recent examples where it is more on the restructuring side, there is a positive outcome that's achieved with a restructure?
Sure, yeah, and these are what we love. It's might be rare you hear insolvency practitioners having good news stories, but we've had some good wins over the last couple of years. Mainly because we deal with good advisors that know the risks and they get their clients in early, and then we do have options to save it. So we've had some good examples recently. We've had a large, in the retail space, large corporate group where with significant tax debt that we've gone and investigated each entity, looked at the structure, they've got some tax advice, and as part of a deed of company arrangement, restructured their affairs. We've got some money back to the tax office. Their other creditors were pretty good within terms. The HR opened to these discussions, and it was a lot of ongoing negotiations with them, and eventually got across the line with a deal to restructure them for around 30 cents of the dollar across the group with some significant tax debt. And again, it keeps the entity trading, everyone employed, and the company viable going forward, coming out leaner and meaner on the other side. There's been a lot done in the construction industry. You read about that in the paper a lot. We've had many of those come in, and in some other form, it depends on the contracts and the support they get from their clients and creditors. It can be quite interesting. People don't like having to pay again for their houses when they've already paid, understandably, but you've got to be open, upfront, transparent, and say, look, this company's in this position, here's worst case for you. We need to work together to get an outcome that sees you get what you want and the company stay viable. It means someone's got to take a haircut at some point. And those have been mainly successful. We've had manufacturing, a large it was in the liquor distillery space. It had a lot of stock being distilled that hadn't aged. Needs about another 6 years to go before it hits its big value, because there's a big demand for whiskey, spirits, vodka, brandy in Australia, given the overseas popularity. Again, large ATO debts, but it's really a capital intensive business. It has to hold this liquor for that period of time and meet all the overheads, and it needs constant, the barrels need turning. There's a lot of work that goes into it to distill and look after the high-end machinery and stills they had there. So again, another VA into a deed of company arrangement. We negotiated with the creditors. We sorted an EOI, and we were successful in that, in getting an equity stake put in. So someone came in, took out the secured financiers and took an equity stake in the business to recapitalise it. So it got back on track, remained viable. Most of the employees stayed employed, and all the creditors, we're about to do our first distribution of the creditors, and they're with the forecast of getting everyone 100 cents in the dollar over a period of another 6 months to go. And we worked with Aiken team on that one. Really successful story, that one. And I'm working on one at the moment, again, in the manufacturing space. Really capital intensive equipment again. Big warehouse. The equipment is fixed in there, so it's worth a lot in a viable going concern business when you're generating revenue and you've got the contracts there. But there's an alternative to sell this off, dismantle it, remove it. The machines are worth next to nothing, and these are multi-million dollar machines in situ. So it limits your options, but again, we've been able to recapitalise that one, get some new equity in there, and the creditors have approved a deed of company arrangement on that one as well. So there are really good tools to use. Again, when companies are proactive, you're seeking advice early. We've got a good network, run a campaign, get new money in there to recapitalise, and the options are really looking good for these companies now. Credit is getting a return as well. So
great, thanks, Shane. Aaron, we've touched on what companies can do when there are claims they potentially want to bring when they're in financial distress. Can you talk a little bit about what they can do to proactively address issues that arise to avoid litigation that they're on the receiving end of in similar times?
Yeah, I think a consensus that we've all reached today is get advice early. So hopefully we avoid litigation altogether. Another one which we touched on earlier was to keep that line of communication open. Often it is that someone gets frustrated because their questions or concerns aren't being addressed, that all of a sudden you go silent, and that's probably the worst thing that you can do. So whether that is keeping the line of communication open and also without prejudice correspondence. So hopefully you can negotiate a settlement yourself, but something really to keep in mind is to actually look first at what you can and can't afford in that settlement. Often the stress of a pending litigation, people just want the deal done and they don't actually think about what they can and can't stick to, and then they end up in a worse situation down the track. So don't just look to settle on whatever terms. You need to make sure that you can actually afford and follow through. And part of that as well is in these times relying on the reputation that you've built. So hopefully throughout the years with your clients and suppliers, you've built a history and a reputation of paying on time or keeping that line of communication open. So when something does happen, you can fall back on that, and you've got that kind of level of trust there already, which then you can build on to negotiate.
It's a beautiful segue to my next question. It was for Mick and Shane about the creditor relationship, and Aaron in part has addressed that, but what can businesses do to make sure they're managing that creditor relationship well? We've spoken about the ATO, I suppose I'm talking more about general suppliers, trade creditors and the like.
I will circle back on ATO, because we get a lot of our traction in payment arrangements or any other sort of negotiation with the ATO leverages off really good payment history historically and really good lodgement history historically. And you know, you start displaying that and you start being able to negotiate a little easier. You don't have that. Things become a lot harder, a lot quicker. Other general creditors, communication. You'll often see that the clients will be, they're paying their materials and they're paying their payroll every month or fortnight. They don't miss it. But it's the creditors and the people that will actually help them build the thing and keep the business going and keep the revenue going, and not the overheads. And unfortunately, they forget about the accounts and they forget about the lawyers. But so we're probably the ones they need to pay as well. So managing all your stakeholders, not just the ones that actually, you know, turn around and generate revenue.
Yeah. And as Aaron said, trust is a key thing. And usually by the time it comes to me and we're looking at it, trying to do a deal with creditors, the trust is broken. There's no trust there. They're fed up, they've had enough, they want their money, or sometimes they won't look at a deal commercially. They say, no, I've had enough of this company, I would rather see it wound up. And you get those sometimes vindictive suppliers or creditors that they've been strung along for a long time, and you can understand it, but that presents another challenge for us to try and work through. And we go and meet with them and talk through the numbers and try and get them to see it from a commercial lens. This is best outcome for you financially and for all the other stakeholders as well. So it's important not to put their head in the sand, to deal with and be transparent with suppliers and creditors and keep the relationship as intact as possible in the circumstances.
And I suppose to conclude and just to bring the conversation full circle, can I ask each of you to reflect on any key tips that you might have for SME businesses when they are facing these difficulties in the current climate? Mick, can I throw to you first?
Yeah, when I read that, the first thing I thought of was don't go buy a yacht. cash is king at the moment, and lifestyle spend should probably be considered a little bit more heavily. Look, interest rates going up, yes, but the physical cash flow of the repayments going out are very difficult. Most of my conversations with clients at the moment is about trying to control repayments. Mick, I'm paying too much. Should I sell one of my properties? And that's combined with I'm sick of land tax in Victoria, I don't want to pay that either. But they're probably the three things. Watch your bank covenants. With all these ratios changing, revenues going down, I've got a couple of clients that have one of their bank covenants is that, you know, percentage of revenue last year has to be maintained for this year. Well, that's really under the lens at the moment. So watch that and your liquidity ratios. But the bank covenants is huge at the moment, I'd say.
Erin, can I throw to you with that same question?
Yeah, I think no longer expect for tax debts and similar debts to be swept under the rug. I think be well aware that they will be pursued. Internal processes, I think, are really important as well. So not just your debt recovery processes, and it does take just one of those to go wrong to end up in a really bad situation, but also creating something internally which shows key warning signs, particularly for your business, about what financial strain might look like, and like a flow chart essentially of the least severe to the most severe. And often, you know, the really severe stuff are the ones, you know, not paying employees on time, superannuation, debts, tax. Those are the really severe ones. So then at least you can regularly refer to it and make sure that it's front of mind.
I'll just segue in there. One of the most biggest things I'm seeing isn't payment, non-payment of BAS or GST or whatnot. Most of my letters at the moment are about superannuation and superannuation not being paid, which is one of those ones right at the bottom of your creditor listing that you're just not paying because nothing comes out of it from a business point of view, or someone very cash-strapped. It's the last thing they really want to pay.
And employees might not tend to check it and know, and they can get away with it for a period of time.
And that's why the ATO treat it so seriously, because you're not paying your employees. That is essentially what
it's still payroll.
Yeah.
Shane,
right.
How about yourself?
Yeah, I see directors don't necessarily know the position. They don't have up-to-date, accurate numbers because they're not going to see Michael to do their accounting, I presume. so they don't know the positioning. So I'm winning all this great work and I've got these contracts coming in. So we drill down into the numbers. Are we going to finish this project in a VA? They're making losses on it, and it looks good on paper, this $1 million contract, but it's costing them more to service it. So they're getting further and further behind. So it would be have your accurate, up-to-date records, know your financial position, know what your exposure is, because then you can make informed decisions as to what you need to do next.
Can I throw to anyone either online or in the room for any questions? Yes, John.
Thanks. there have been some interesting comments about needing to be proactive, get on the front foot, get advice early, don't stick your head in the sand. Mike made a comment earlier on which I thought was really telling when he talked about three-way four ghosts. And the comment he made, as I recall, was that the banks are paying more attention to that than directors. And my question is, would the most valuable piece of proactive advice be to get these SME owners to establish a board of some description, a governance board or an advisory board at least, that holds them accountable? Because it seems to me with the clients that I work with, that you've got exactly the situation you talked about. You've got an entrepreneur who has got a rear view mirror and just keeps going forward and forward and forward. Doesn't see the problem, and there's nobody actually holding them accountable or making sure they've got proper balance and they're heading in the right direction.
Great.
Can you just repeat that for online?
Oh, sorry.
I can if you want.
It,
yeah, I'll repeat.
Thanks.
So the question was, in addition to my commentary around forecasting and at least being able to look forward and do some work, should clients and SME clients have advisory boards or boards of directors around that to actually be held accountable to those numbers? Absolutely, and I probably failed to go there earlier, that there's one piece of it, which is build forecast, enjoy forecast, and it sits on a shelf somewhere. So yes, I'd say half the time the bank want to see it, they probably want to tick a box. They don't tend to be revisiting it all that much. Half of my work would be me reporting to boards of either a board of directors or an advisory board on a monthly basis. So a forecast would be 12 months of a financial year. Month end closes off, we review it, drop the actuals in, and every month we're dropping actuals in against the forecast. You've got essentially a rolling forecast, what we call. And I report that to the boards. And now we're talking in real terms, we talk about real information. I've now gone for 6 months, I'm doing okay, but I'm thinking a couple of things are going to drop off and I don't have enough people and I've got a problem in 6 months' time. And so it isn't just the preparation of the forecast you bang on, it's then being held accountable to it, but then tracking the actuals to it, which is where we do a lot of work as well. Yep. unfortunately, that's not much for the banks, that they tend not to be watching that, which is really silly. That show really should be.
Yeah, it certainly is that tick the box. It's
yeah,
you need
is.
To have it there,
yep.
But you still need someone there, whether it's the directors or some sort of board, to actually police that and hold people accountable, as John said.
Yeah, it's also the key advisors. It's good to have a board, and that's probably more the sophisticated directors or larger businesses that's going to apply to, but you don't have to do a course to be a director. You don't have to do a basic bookkeeping course even. So it's the lawyers and accountants, the key advisors that should be pushing, and a lot of the proactive ones are, I know you do, that what are your regulatory requirements? How should you be keeping your records? What should you be looking at? Because people can just go off and register with ASIC and be a director and incur heaps of debt and run off into the sunset. I've always had a big bugbear about that, and think there should be a mandatory course, at least they should be doing, but not so far.
Agreed.
Yeah, on that point, you'd be surprised how many directors we speak to who just have no idea what their obligations are. And it's not that they're trying to be deceitful and get around them, it's just that they don't have people around them to say, this is what you need to be doing. And I find kind of the worst culprits for that are people who are trained, particularly in a trade. They're fantastic at what they do, and then they go and start a business for themselves with no business experience. And that they're the people which often kind of get caught in that. Yeah.
And the business can grow because they're good at what they do, but then they're not equipped to actually deal with the things that flow from that. Yes, Anthony?
Yeah, I know it's a basic question, you may have touched on it, but what are the forced closures of a business? I think you said administration, bankruptcy and liquidation, and who can actually trigger those, and is it compulsory to have legal and accounting input in each of those processes?
So for online, the question was, what are the forced closures of a business, who can drive them, and is there a requirement to get accounting and legal advice in each of those contexts?
So if it's compulsory closure, it'd normally be via a court liquidation or enforcement of debt, either from financiers, any creditor, anyone that's owed money can wind up a company. So they'll issue a demand via their lawyer, it ends up in a statutory demand and then a winding up application. So the court makes an order to wind it up. Banks can appoint receivers or agents for mortgagee in possession, and they're taking control over particular assets or property. But they're your main two, a liquidation and a receivership. There's other voluntary regimes that directors and shareholders can do themselves if they've need to do adhere to their duties or the company's not viable going forward. But for the compulsory ones, it's by enforcement of debt.
And bankruptcy, is that something that you can enforce yourself as an owner, or someone outside of you can enforce?
Both. So bankruptcy applying to individuals, so people in their own right, not companies. Just a terminology change, but so creditors can enforce a bankruptcy through pursuing their debt, or you can apply yourself and become voluntary bankrupt as well. And there's some talks at the moment about tweaking bankruptcy period. It goes for 3 years. They're talking about reducing it and potentially giving bankrupts a one-off free hit. You come out almost immediately if the debt's under a certain level, because they know there's going to be a big wave coming in the future, and they're quite labour-intensive to administer a bankruptcy for 3 years. You've got to keep making sure they're compliant, and the overheads are quite high even if there's no property there to realise. So they're looking at streamlining it, which is going to be interesting how that plays out. There's a lot for and a lot against it too, I think. People are just going to go and have a free hit at incurring a heap of debt and running away. So.
Yes, Bernard.
As a private client tax advisor, I spend a lot of my time asset protection. Just wondering, taking your liquidation bankruptcy the next step further, and I've gone bankrupt and I owe $10 million. Well, I don't have any assets, but I've restructured over the years. Could you just tell me just generally what weaknesses there are in that, such as I gave my family home to my spouse, or I inherited money only last year and I've suddenly got $10 million because your mummy died.
Yeah.
Where does that all sit as a procedure?
For the benefit of online, Bernard asked a question about asset protection and what happens in particular scenarios if you do go through one of these processes and then you either later come into some money or there are other issues that arise down the track. So I think Shane can
Fill that one. So we, in a corporate wind-up or liquidation, our claims are only directly to the assets of the company, but we do have claims available and powers as liquidators to pursue directors, related parties, other parties if they've received company property or money. We can flow that through into the asset if it's being held in a different entity. There's provisions in the Corporations Act that enable us to see through the transaction and void it and recall the money back. In a bankruptcy, if bankrupts get good advice, there are methods there for asset protection. We all love our partners and want to be nice and generous and give them our house and our asset. That may or may not work. There are voidable transaction provisions also in a bankruptcy. You can see through to the money if the house has been paid for by the bankrupt or upkeep or maintenance, or the equity has been derived from the bankrupt's income, personal exertion, the property's still up for grabs. Might mean there's got to be a legal claim run and a court order obtained, but it's not off the table just because it's been transferred into a partner's name. You've got to look through and see how the equity in that asset's been derived, so it can still be attacked.
And to come back to the piece that's flowed through a lot of today, being proactive and planning in advance is going to be critical. It's when you do things in that immediate sense of, uh-oh, I'm in trouble here, I'm going to transfer property or I'm going to do something clever to avoid, that's when you end up with difficulties. So asset protection is always done better 10 years in advance rather than 10 minutes in advance. I think, John, do you have another question?
Yeah, just a quick one about whether fintech finance is changing the environment, lending environment at the moment. I was working with a client, set up an advisory board, which you quoted in pretty quickly. A small SME that was clearly in trouble and really needed to go through a liquidation and then a restructure, which was advised from the advisory board. But then we found that the owner, for absolutely no reason I could work out, had gone off and got quite a substantial fintech loan which had no conceivable way of repaying. My advice to the advisory board was, we're just out of here. We're not a governance board, we're not official, but we're still out of here because we're not taking our advice. But what staggered me was that they were able to get $100,000 or whatever with no assets. Their business was clearly broken. And so my question is the fintech loan, the availability of fintech finance by banks tightening up, is that changing the environment, and just how vicious are those companies likely to be in chasing debt? Because that was my big concern as well.
So John's question is around the availability of fintech finance to businesses on little due diligence, and probably applies more generally to second and third tier financiers generally rather than specifically to fintech. But what effect does that have? What do you see that flowing through to in the insolvency context? I mean, Shane, perhaps I can throw to you. And
I don't know what you're seeing on the front line for lenders, but
I don't see a lot of my clients going and applying for them. Second tier lenders, yes, but there's a little bit more work involved there, so that's actually okay. But from a fintech, not my client base, sorry.
We've had companies that you see these loans on the balance sheet and you're asking, what are they secured over? Oh, nothing. And it was unheard of. It's happening more and more. You're seeing it more and more often over the last sort of 5 years. I've seen a lot more of them. There's certain, the same names keep coming up and they're advancing hundreds of thousands of dollars with no security, no guarantee even, and they've just got to take the hit. And just shows how much money they have available, and they've got to hit their KPIs and keep lending that out. So these are tightening up, just based on what I'm reading. Yes, but I've just seen two big deals done in Australia. It must be a nice, viable, sound business. It is in the tech space, but they've just had $150 million capital raise done and got a loan to do that and got some equity in there. But it's amazing what they'll lend on and the hits that I'm seeing them take as well. So wouldn't be surprised if they change their approach.
In terms of their follow-up and enforcement, that was my concern. I assume they're pretty groovy.
Well, there's not much they can do because they're not secured. They're unsecured credit like everybody else. So they don't have any additional rights. So they can... these ones that have come to me have been ATO-driven and the creditor sits back. They're not even really proactive in communicating, or they didn't know. They didn't know the company was in financial trouble, and they get told when I tell them, and, okay, thanks, see you later.
And presumably they charge
accept that risk.
A huge amount of interest to mitigate against some of that risk.
That's right,
I mean, Shane spoke earlier about, the flow-on effect from the major banks being a little bit more restrictive in their lending requirements, and so then that flows down to second-tier lenders, and then obviously that pushes other businesses down to that sort of lenders of last resort, to use that expression, where you know, it comes at a significant cost, and yes, there might be less of a due diligence aspect, but comes at a significant cost. And even if you can, you know, turn the business around a little bit to get it more cash flow positive, you've got this 20% interest loan that you've got to service and then or higher, as John is gesturing to me, but that's quite right, and it means that your chances of that turnaround are much lower than if you've just been proactive and sought advice at the appropriate time. Yes.
We had a question submitted in advance about the construction industry, which was about a lot of the builders going under, and this was quite specific to individual circumstances, but with high volume builders, what are some of the direct liability issues that you might have seen over the last few years?
Yeah, so it's a good question. They're exposed for breaching duties. They continue to trade whilst insolvent. They're incurring debt they ought to have known they can't pay. They're exposed to liquidators for claims, being the amount of the unpaid creditors that have been incurred personally. They're exposed under personal guarantees that they've given to suppliers. They're exposed on, usually more often than not, put their house up to the bank as security as well. So the longer they continue to trade and incur debt, they're getting further and further behind if this company isn't viable coming and going to be able to come out of it. They're putting their own assets up and putting their own liability is increasing, and they lose a lot. You see it, they end up bankrupt, then the cycle starts and lose the house, get sold, and the kids are taken out of school, and they've got to change the whole life. And because they didn't get advice earlier, they didn't act on that advice. And again, come back to that being proactive, can cost them everything.
Mm-hmm. So. We've got a few at the moment for specifically in the trades, and they do give those personal guarantees to get supplies. And the amount of credit limits that they're able to get are quite enormous, particularly for the size of their business that they're running. And they're always personal guaranteeing them. Otherwise, they won't get the credit limit for the supplies. So that's where we're seeing the downfall of them, and they're being really pursued. We've got two at the moment. And they are not willing to negotiate. They're very experienced litigants. They know that the debt was incurred. The personal guarantees are tight. The interest is within the range that it should be, so there's really not much wiggle room that they have once a default happens to try and negotiate, really, other than just paying the debt in full.
And the thing that always concerns me is question number one or two that I ask, and probably some around this table ask as well, is, well, what debts have you personally guaranteed? And it is remarkable how often the answer is, I have no idea. And when you dig in a little bit further, they have personally guaranteed a significant amount of the trade debt. They've probably got bank guarantees and things like that up behind it as well. So that comes back to knowing the business, knowing the financial position, and knowing your own exposure, because it is relevant to all of these things about the availability of positive restructuring and turnaround can be dependent on factors like that. So be aware of your position, including that personal guarantee.
Without notice question. Where you have that personal guarantee, and you might exit the business. I might exit the business. I probably don't know what I've guaranteed, but maybe I do. How do I get out of them if I've left the business?
Get good legal advice, Mick. it should always be a condition of your exit from a business that all of those are dealt with. So it would be by agreement with both the person providing the finance, and if it's a bank or if it's another financier, what they're going to be concerned about is, okay, well, if I let you out of this liability
where am I getting
guarantee,
it?
Where am I getting it?
Yeah, okay.
So it's get advice and don't leave until that position is clarified, because you do see that occasionally.
Yeah, I've seen it.
They're out of the business and they're still like, well, why am I on the hook for this? Because you didn't deal with it at the time.
Yeah.
Any other questions? No? Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for your attendance, both in person and online. We'll be in touch with a topic for our next month's business brekkie briefing shortly. So thank you very much. And thanks to our panelists.
Thank you.